Hi, welcome to week three of my series of four videos introducing my brand new CD, Elevate. I'm Will Donato. Thank you for joining me. And I just want to let you know this album is an album of friendship, and I could have easily titled the songs by my friends' names, but my legal department, Myers and Jacoby, didn't think that was a good idea. I want you to know my CD's coming out October 30th, and also I hope you enjoyed the first video, which was my video from Infinite Soul, which was my number one Billboard hit, and very proud of it with my dream team, produced by Greg Manning. And I can't wait to share this whole album with you. I hope it elevates your mood, and I hope it takes you to a joyous musical place. Oh, shameless promotion alert. A Will Donato, you got this coffee mug. What a coincidence. World premiere. You got this video, and a Will Donato, you got this coffee cup. As long as you're here, my beautiful wife is bringing me coffee shamelessly on a Will Donato, you got this mug. And my wife has what I call the best ears in the business, and also the Academy of Recording Arts and Sciences said they're also the prettiest. Aww. This is Diana Donato, my wife, and an integral part of sequencing this album and getting through the songs and giving me wonderful advice and critiques on the flow and the process of the music. And she is also Miss Coachella Valley 2020 and every year!
Not.
And birthday girl.
Aww.
Happy birthday,
babe. Thank you,
babe. You got this coffee mug available online and retailers near you. Thank you.
Mwah.
You're great.
Bye.
Even more breaking news. It says it right there. My special guest today is recording artist, guitarist, phenom, Terry Wolman. And Terry's brand new CD project, Cosini's Last Dance, has been nominated on the Grammy ballot in two categories. And congratulations, Terry. I'm so happy to have you on the show today. Terry played on my new album, Elevate, and did such an amazing job. Terry's performances are always stunning, signature, almost cinematic. Terry, I love you, brother. And we also are going to show a video of him playing in the signature band from Byron Allen's TV show. And it was a truly an all-star band with Gerald Albright and Nathan East and other luminaries and in the band. This song features them playing with the one and only Al Jarreau. Roll tape.
The Dream Band. You know what? I want to introduce the Dream Band. Our music director is Terry Wolman. Terry Wolman.
Thank you, Bob.
On sax, we have Gerald Albright. On bass, we have Nathan East. On keyboards, we have Mark Hugenberger. And on percussions, we have Louise Cante. And keeping the beat, Kevin Cloud. The Dream Band.
Oh, welcome to the show, y'all. That's a great video featuring Terry Wolman performing with the amazing Byron Allen Band, filled with stellar artists. And it is my pleasure to introduce my pal and stunning guitarist, Mr. Terry Wolman. Terry, that was an amazing video.
Thank you, Will. It's great to see you. It was so fun to see that video again for me, too, because I hadn't seen it for a long time, and it brought back great memories. That was a dream job for me, music directing for late night talk show. I loved it. Absolutely loved it. And that band was magnificent.
You know, that was a very special time. And I would say television and also Los Angeles, California, where you have these amazing house bands. I know they had them back east and the Letterman bands and the Tonight Show bands. But I thought we had our offerings that were really amazing with young artists like yourselves at the time that were just delivering night after night. But I just wanted to thank you, Terry,
I am so grateful to have you on my new project. And you played on a beautiful song called Beyond Forever. I sent you the material. We collaborated. I got back these beautiful pieces of gold. And I just love working with you. We had a chance to do a Christmas single.
Yeah, Terry, Renaissance Christmas. Sing your praises. That was wonderful. Oh, thank you.
Beautiful. And I just sing your praises. I just wondered if you could describe your process for when you work with someone like myself or another artist, when you get a track in the mail and you assess maybe a roadmap for the song, what is your particular game plan?
That's a great question. The first thing that I do is I just listen with an open mind and open heart, just to, I'm not looking on how to insert myself into your music. I'm looking to see what I can do to serve your music and elevate it. Literally. Yeah. Yeah. And the beauty is, if when I stay open to that, new things happen. And I'm always looking to find a new way to approach music on every song and with every artist, including my own song. So basically what I did was I just listened to it. And then I had a conversation with you and asked, what are you looking for? What do you have in mind? Are you thinking electric guitar, acoustic guitar, nylon, mandolin, like sort of eclectic instruments, electric guitar, great. Like power chords, wah-wah pedal, like how far can I go? So those are the questions that I asked. And I also believe I shared a couple of my ideas with you to see if that made sense. And you basically told me what you were looking for intention-wise and emotionally what you were looking for, and color-wise. You certainly had a very clear vision of where you wanted the song to go, but you also gave me an incredible amount of freedom and encouraged me to approach it as I would my own project, which is just to see what fits, to see what works. So, and there was one point along the way where I felt like it would be really interesting to add another layer, and you hadn't asked me to do that. So I reached out to see if you were okay with it, and you were very open to it. And so I sent it to you, and I basically sent you, I believe, a couple of options, not too many choices, but you know, I would go a little bit, you know, in the deep end of the pool and take some more chances. I would also give you another version that was a little bit more just right in the pocket and perhaps more repetitive, or I wouldn't say boring by any means, because I love repetition, but something that was not as maybe atonal, you know, but I gave you one that was like a little bit out there, and which you actually ended up using a lot of, which was, I thought was wonderful. But I also, I always attempt to deliver tracks in a way that are just going to fit right in with what you're doing so that you don't have to fix things.
Wow. Well, I'm going to let you in on a little secret over here at Camp Donato. When we get tracks from someone like you, we call it Christmas over here. You know what? It's just, I love giving free rein to my artist friends, and because it makes it fun for me too to go, holy cow, look at this. And I'm just really proud of what we did on the holiday album too. And
me too.
I just love it. It was absolutely perfect. It was like, I don't think you gave me guitar parts. You gave me a clinic on studio guitar work and a workshop. It was a workshop.
I thank you very much for saying that. I appreciate it. It was such a perfect way for us to begin our recording collaboration, because we've performed together before, but the Renaissance Christmas single and project was, it was a really beautiful way to begin recording together.
It was absolutely perfect, Terry. I just loved it. And I know we're going to move along here, but I just have to tell you, before COVID, I was thinking of my favorite memories from last year and being in Laguna with you and the band and Melanie and Melanie's mom and the Christmas show. Those, I had a great year, and those were highlights. The day in Laguna was real special. It was a real beautful day, and the audience was, you know, came to be celebrated. So kudos to you for creating an environment for us to just celebrate people.
Well,
so
you're always welcome. I can't wait to play with you again once it's safe to get out.
I love it. And, you know, I'm such a fan of your career and your point of view and your trajectory. I just wondered if you could give us a real quick arc of Terry Woolman arriving in Los Angeles in 81.
Yeah. So I moved from Miami, where I was born and raised. I went to school in Boston at Berkeley. put myself through college, took out student loans, got in my Honda station wagon and drove cross country with
a juicer,
with a champion juicer. Yeah. and an electric guitar and an acoustic guitar and basically, and some clothes and came out here and just kind of hit the ground running to the best of my ability. But it was pretty hard, you know, it was hard to meet people, yeah, to make friends. I would say it was challenging, especially like my very first month, once I had to put down, you know, I came out with $1,000 in my pocket that I'd saved up for the move. And most of it was gone with a first and last month's rent and a cleaning deposit. And wow, I had to make a decision on whether I was going to get a futon mattress or an answering machine. Well, you know which one I went with, the answering machine.
That's right.
Yeah, that was the first month. I got the mattress the second month. So that's how I started. I got a job parking cars on the weekends to make some money, which, by the way, that led to having an opportunity to audition for Billy Preston, because the drummer was parking cars between tours and we were playing together and had become really good friends. Another thing, I went in for a meeting with Sid Garris and George Greif Garris Management. They managed the new Christie Minstrels and Jose Feliciano and a bunch of people, but they also managed Joe Sample and the Crusaders. Through that meeting, I ended up meeting Joe and ended up doing orchestrations for him for the Tokyo Philharmonic and was kind of Joe's assistant. And he became my mentor and friend. And I was a fly on the wall anytime. If I wasn't working, but they had a session, I would ask if I could just come and sit. By the way, I ended up singing on Styx Hooper's album. You know,
I love Styx Hooper.
Fly on the wall. Yeah, wonderful drummer. And you know, he said, do you sing? And I go, no. And he goes, well, but you can sing, like you can hold a pitch. And I go, I'm not really a singer. He goes, but you can hold a pitch, right? And I go, yeah. He goes, come here, let's try something. And I ended up, you know, singing on a single with them that ended up getting
I'm gonna hear it.
It's called Give Me Some Space. Go find it. It got a Grammy nomination for best R&B vocal, which just totally blew my mind. It was Styx and I singing the chorus of this cool funk tune. So it was pretty amazing. So that was my first year. But when I came back from the Billy Preston tour, I found that, okay, here's my touring career. Now it's begun, and that's not the way it happened. So I ended up putting my own band together. And from that, basically just started writing more music because I needed music to play in the band. And I had always written songs, but I started writing instrumental music just so we had things to play and use the best musicians that I could get my hands on. Started playing, ended up making my first record in 1988, Bimini, mastered by Steve Hall, who just mastered your new record.
Yeah,
amazing. It. And then I got a call to work. A lot of my things have come through side doors. You know, music directing for Wilson Phillips was kind of a side door thing. But I ended up getting asked to go take a meeting at Fox for the Late Show on Fox, which was the Joan Rivers show. And then it came on for another year after with Jack Mack and the Heart Attack as a house band. I was the music director for that show. And from that, I got my television experience. And then I was recommended to Byron Allen for the video that we just saw. Met with him and did the pilot and then put this all-star band together and music directed for his show for 3 years. So somehow, because I was open-minded, open to becoming an artist, even though that wasn't my intention, and also open to walking in through a kitchen door sometimes instead of the front or the back door, but just kind of saying yes to things that might lead to an opportunity that led to me becoming a music director for two national late-night talk shows. That's the short version.
I thought LA was really exciting in the 80s and 90s. I mean, and even in those days, we had bands that were really relevant, like even Chili Peppers and a lot of those bands, Guns N' Roses, they were kids in the 80s and everybody was playing somewhere. You could have a big band, you could showcase. I'm sure the Cherry Woman band was probably at my place, or the Strand, or the Blue Lagoon, Madam Wong's. It was so great. It was so great back then. And And I
the first Terry Wallman Band gig was at the Comedy Store on Sunset Boulevard. They decided they were going to have music on a Sunday night.
Wow. And that was a magical place in the 80s. Pryor would still come in and those days. And wow. Well, I sing your praises almost weekly, Terry. You brought so much artistry to my projects, and I listen to my new record and I just smile. I don't really call them by songs. I go by the friends that play on the songs. That's how much I've got invested in just the friendships in these albums. And I want to commend you for doing a project, and I wonder if you could describe it. Then we're going to roll tape on your Get Out the Vote effort. I just would love you to just let our listeners know about the Get Out the Vote.
Well,
what you're up to.
Thank you. This is a labor of love for everybody involved. And it's a labor of passion for people like myself who are concerned about our country and are having trouble sleeping at night with all of this. With COVID and with all the divisiveness in our country and racial unrest and everything, it's hard to sleep. And I thought, well, what can I do about it? I can write. So I co-wrote a song called Beautiful Sound of Us with Lillooet Fox and Ray Jupiter, and who's a new artist, and ended up putting a virtual choir together of over 30 actors and singers. We did this remotely because of the pandemic. And I reached out to a friend of mine, Donald Weber Jr., who I had the pleasure of working with on an HBO movie last year called The Bronx, USA. And I'd met Donald in New York. Donald is from the original Hamilton cast of the Broadway cast of Hamilton. So he's a rapper and a singer and a fantastic actor. I rewrote the lyrics to the verse to really put it towards empowering and encouraging everybody to vote. Quite simple.
Yes.
And I heard Donald's voice in my mind, spoken word and rap and vocal. So I reached out to him, told him the idea, played him my demo, and he loved it and sang it, and then actually said, we should do a video. And I said, I know exactly what to do. What are you thinking? I'll tell you what I'm thinking. We both have the same vision, because we had already talked about the intention of the song. The words are, they're not anti-Trump. They're not pro-Biden. I stand with Biden personally, but and I'm deeply concerned about our country and the loss of democracy.
Jill or Joe Biden?
Joe. they're both really smart people. But this is a bipartisan song and video that we did. We all came together to make it, and it was just released about a week ago. And again, the idea, it's called Beautiful Sound of Us. And it really, we don't sugarcoat the lyrics, but it's really about every voice matters. And if you don't think so, then you're missing a very important part of living in America. Everybody needs to register and vote.
Good on you, Terry. Let's roll tape.
Thank you.
Yo, listen, I finally see someone who looks like me standing proud and strong on my TV, saying it's no mystery we can change the course of history with our passion and integrity. Be assured, it's time for our voices to be heard.
Crushing fences, tearing down the walls. We are a chain of love that connects us all. Can you hear the call? The most beautiful sound of us. Most beautiful sound of us.
Yo, lifting up the veil,
lift the veil
and
up,
revealing all the lies,
all the lies
as we dedicate this moment to exercise the power.
power and privilege that every person has.
Oh yeah.
If we vote, then we've won. Woo. And we're ready for the change, that has begun. We're ready.
Crushing fences.
Crushing
tearing
fences,
down the walls.
Tearing down the walls.
We're a chain of love that connects us all. Can you hear the most beautiful sound of all.
You may feel like your voice is not important, but it's more important than ever. Without your voice, we're nothing. We need you. We need you. We need your voice.
I just want to commend you once more, Terry, for taking the time and talents and manpower to put this beautiful project together. I also wanted to encapsulate and describe one of a great moment on our show that we do together, Jack Cohen and I, Inside the Music, where you helped orchestrate two-time Grammy winner Melissa Manchester singing the Christmas song with R&B legend Phil Perry.
Yeah.
And that's all. Those are two constellations that you need to collide, and what a great moment that was. I would wonder if you could describe the setup and the origin of that whole project and get together.
By the way, it was a really special moment for the three of us as well. I typically would not speak for Melissa or Phil, but we were all in complete agreement after the fact, and even before the fact. The idea of it. When you invited me to be a part of the show, and then those were going to be the two guests with me, I just couldn't do it without at least asking if we might be able to all play a song together, the three of us. And you and Jack were very encouraging about it. And so I reached out to Melissa and to Phil and said, let's do a song. Let's do a Christmas song together. And we basically collaboratively came up with the idea to do that song. We talked about the keys, and they both were going to sing it in different keys, so there was a modulation, and we kind of just talked it through, and then we did it, and then this magic happened, and it was really just an exquisite moment for me. It was really beautiful.
You know, I think you just highlighted what a producer does. A producer creates an environment and then propels great performances, and I think that's what you do, Terry. And it's really a privilege having you on the show. And thank you on a very personal level for adding to my new record. It's just, again, I should just put your names on each song title and not the song titles. Song number 8 is Terry. I love you, brother.
Congratulations. I love you too. Congratulations on Elevate. I'm really proud of you, and I'm proud to be a part of your record and your music.
Terry.
And yes, stay safe as well. Everybody stay safe and stay inspired. And thanks for having me. If you want to see the full video again, watch this, or just go to terrywallman.com, and there will be links there. And by the way, everybody, share it. This one's not about me. It's about all of us.
Thank you, buddy. Stay safe, comfortable, and healthy. Sending love your way.
Thanks, Will.
But just musically,
right?
Exactly. You know, as I dove deeper into each of these songs, going back to the original recordings and listening again to the essence of the songs, I realized how important these songs were to me as well. That mm-hmm. because it's just part, and not just American culture, but world culture.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's fantastic.
It's fantastic. You know, one of the things is that's always amazed me is that Nat recorded this song almost 63 or 64 years ago.
Was mm-hmm. he the first?
I think he was the first. Mm. Now, it's this is a Mel Torme song.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I'm sure that Mel had a version that existed before Nat's version.
Well, he did the demo.
Yeah, but back then, for all we know,
yeah,
he might have did a 1 o'clock in the morning session. We don't
yes.
know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Demos, even though they were done back then, were viewed quite differently.
Absolutely.
Back then.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
And on big old 78s.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But you had mm-hmm. great, just like now, you had great players back then.
Mm-hmm.
Who gave of themselves on their instrument to make the listener feel like it was their song that they
Absolutely.
Were playing.
Mm-hmm.
And the love affair between music and musician and music and lyricist and music and singer, that never goes away.
No.
Never goes
no.
away. Mm-hmm. I love this tune. It says, chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost nipping at your nose, Yuletide carols being sung by a choir, and folks dressed up like Eskimos.
Everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe will help to keep the season bright. Tiny tots with our eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way. He's bringing lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if reindeer really know,
do they know
how to fly.
And so I'm offering this simple phrase
to kids from 1 to 92,
that's including you.
Although
it's been said
many times, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. sure am hoping you have a Merry Christmas.
You all can exhale now. That was amazing.
Wow. That was sweet as a fish.
No,
but that's why I wanted you to resolve.
That's
before
right. I got you. I got you right.
That was magic.
I see.
We have a world premiere tonight of a new video. It's the third video we've had in each week of this series. So we have a world premiere. It says world premiere right there. Our budget went up. Enjoy this video. It's my radio single called You Got This. Also, the coffee cup, where's that? You Got This. Baristas agree, coffee tastes better in a Will Donato You Got This mug. And we are going to roll tape right now. Roll tape. want to thank you guys for stopping by for week three of my CD premiere for the new CD Elevate. I want to thank my social media director and my management, Sundial Agency, Robert McLean, and of course, Jack Cohen, Diana Donato, Greg Manning, and the Dream Team. Shout outs to Curtis McCain and the crew. I love you guys dearly. I'll see you guys next Monday night, and I'm going to take a sip of my coffee from the Will Donato You Got This mug. Have a great week, you guys. Please stay safe, comfortable, and healthy.